Hello everyone and welcome to the first part of the webinar series hosted by R&R Law Chambers. Today's topic deals with the interplay of arbitrability of shareholder disputes vis-a-vis petitions alleging oppression of shareholders and or mismanagement of affairs of a company. To assist us on the issue today, we are pleased to welcome Mr. S.N. Mukherjee, Senior Advocate, and Mr. Dhruv Diwan, Advocate. Mukherjee, of course, needs no introduction from us. Most of us have had the privilege of being led by him in various matters, and he is without a doubt considered to be an authority on company matters. We also have Dhruv today with us, who is an advocate based out of Delhi. Dhruv mostly handles commercial litigation and has also assisted Mr. Mukherjee in various cases. Before we begin the webinar, I would invite Rohan to set out today's structure of webinar.
Thank you, Reena, for the introduction. Today, we've divided the session into three segments. The first session is the discussion on the legal issue itself, which is whether the arbitration clause per se excludes the NCLT jurisdiction under sections 241, 242 of the Companies Act 2013. After that, we will move on to the case problem, which was circulated earlier today. And in that, both the speakers will be giving their arguments for either party. Following the case problem would be the last round, which is the question and answer. I would be requesting all the participants to please post their questions in the Q&A tab, which is available to them on the Zoom platform. Now, in terms of the first part, Mr. Mukherjee will begin the discussion by talking about this legal issue. He would be talking about the legal evolution of this issue right from the old company law till the recent amendments. He will also be giving his insights into this issue. Following that would be the second speaker, Dhruv, who would also be giving his thoughts on the legal subject. And in the end, Mr. Mukherjee will be summing up the legal position and would be sharing some strategic considerations and practical drafting tips for all of us practitioners. Now, may I request Mr. Mukherjee to please open the discussion.
Good evening, everybody. And thank you, R&R, for having me in your first webinar in these very uncertain times. Webinars is one of the methods by which I've kept myself busy and tried to keep up to date by speaking about whatever I have learned and I'm still learning. Now, today's topic really is concerning resolving shareholder disputes and the dichotomy between arbitration and an action for oppression and mismanagement. Now, I want to very briefly touch upon the position under the Arbitration Act of 1940. As you are all aware, there was no mandatory provision like Section 8 of the Arbitration and Conciliation Act 1996 in the 1940 Act. The 1940 Act provided for Section 34, which was for stay of proceedings in the event it was covered by the arbitration agreement. And it was a completely discretionary relief as far as the court was concerned. Now, what is important is the position was pretty consistent under the 1940 Act to the effect that a proceeding under Section 397, 398 ought not to be referred to arbitration. And the reasons were many, but the principal reasons were, first, the court's understanding was that the right to relief in proceedings under sections 397 and 398 of the Act was one whose origin was not on any contract, but in the statute itself. Therefore, it was really a statutory right. Second was that no jurisdiction had been vested in the arbitrator under the Companies Act 1956 for the purpose of either adjudicating a Section 397-398 petition or granting reliefs under those provisions as well as under Section 402 and 403 of the Act. And third, which was very important, was that the arbitration agreement was actually violative of Section 9 of the Companies Act 1956 because it sought to deprive a party of its statutory remedy and therefore was contrary to the provisions of the Act, being repugnant to Section 397-398 and therefore could not be enforced. This was basically the position under the 1940 Act and Section 397-398. So at that point of time, other than one or two stray cases where parties agreed before the High Court, because the High Court was then hearing petitions under 397-398, matters were not referred to arbitration when an application was filed under Section 34 of the Arbitration Act 1940. Now, what happens when the 1996 Act comes along? The first decision under the 1996 Act, which was pronounced on contest, if I remember correctly, was the decision of Naveen Kedia and Chennai Power Corporation. That's reported in 1999, 95 company cases, 640. Now, in that case, a Section 45 was filed to refer the disputes to arbitration. Matters were made easy because the petitioner admitted that oppression and mismanagement arose out of the provisions contained in the shareholders' agreement. And so the matter was referred to arbitration. There was really no arguments on arbitrability as such in that matter. The second important case, according to me, was that of Bhadresh Kantilal Shah and Magotteaux. Here again, it was a Section 45 petition. The issue of arbitrability was urged in the sense that a petition, the nature of the dispute in an oppression mismanagement petition was such that even if it was covered by the arbitration agreement, it could not be referred to arbitration. In other words, it was an action in rem, as we understand it from Booz Allen's case. The Company Law Board, however, rejected this argument, but still did not refer the parties to arbitration because there were no commonality of parties in the sense that the parties to the action and parties to the arbitration agreement were not common. And most importantly, the company was not a party to the arbitration agreement. Then came the Air Touch case, which was the principal bench then sitting in Chennai, and the additional principal bench, where the court, the Company Law Board, actually in a Section 45, referred the parties to arbitration. It held that a dispute, which was the subject matter of 397-398 proceedings, could be referred to arbitration. Both these cases actually relied on a unreported order of the Supreme Court, which was passed in Section 111 proceedings and had referred the matter to arbitration. I'll just give you very briefly the background of this. Section 111 petition had been filed. The application had been made to refer the matter to arbitration. That had been rejected. Matter went up to the High Court in a 10F. High Court also rejected it. When it came to the Supreme Court, Section 8 had come into force. and it was a rectification petition, and the Supreme Court, in a very cryptic order, said, well, now it's mandatory, there is no discretion, therefore we have to refer the matter to arbitration, because admittedly this issue covered by the arbitration agreement. This was 111, again, jurisdiction vested in the Company Law Board under the Act, and the matter was stood referred. And this was what was relied on in holding that it could not be contended that petitions before the Company Law Board, either under Section 397, 398, or 111, were not arbitrable. Now, in the meantime, of course, the Company Law Board continued, and even today, the NCLT continues not to refer petitions under 397, 398 to arbitration if the company is not a party, if necessary parties to the proceedings and the arbitration agreement, there is no commonality, or when a substantial part of the subject matter of the petition is not covered by the arbitration agreement, where the subject matter of the petition are statutory violations, where the subject matter of the shareholders agreement and subject matter of the petition are different, and where arbitration clause did not provide for referring disputes between the company on the one hand and some or all of the shareholders on the other hand. In the sense that though company may be party to the shareholders agreement, the dispute resolution clause did not contemplate disputes between the company and shareholders to be referred to arbitration. And most importantly, in several cases, it was held that where the subject matter of the arbitration agreement had, prior to filing of the proceedings, been made the subject matter of a suit, and none of the parties had objected to the jurisdiction of the civil court to decide such an issue, though covered by the subject matter of the arbitration agreement, or a party who could raise such objection did not, then that very party is deemed to have waived the benefit of the arbitration agreement and could not raise it as an issue in when proceedings were instituted under 397, 398 for the purpose of referring the matter to arbitration. In other words, if somebody has given a go-by to the arbitration agreement, either prior to or during the 397, 398 proceedings in any manner whatsoever, then the matter would not be referred to arbitration. The Act itself quite clearly contemplates one, which is filing a statement as to the first statement as to the substance of the dispute. But even otherwise, waiver has been taken to be a ground if there has been waiver by way of contract. And in Section 45, that was put under the expression arbitration agreement becomes inoperative. And in which case, if you have filed across 397, then that's again waiving your right to go to arbitration for a particular dispute, so it had become inoperative. But all these were on really whether the parties were the same and whether the subject matter of the arbitration agreement covered the subject matter of the action before the judicial authority. On arbitrability then came the first major decision, which was of the Punjab and Haryana High Court. And this is the Hind Samachar case. I think it's Sudarshan Chopra, popularly refers to as Sudarshan Chopra's case. And here, what was held by the division bench of the Punjab and Haryana High Court was actually going back to what was held by the courts under the 1940 Act, that this was a statutory right. There was exclusive jurisdiction vested in the Company Law Board, and an arbitrator could not grant reliefs which could be granted under 241, 242 proceedings, and therefore the matter should not be referred to arbitration. Bennett Coleman was cited, Cosmos Steel was cited, Devi Jhora was cited, and on that basis it was held that these are powers which an arbitral tribunal will never have. And great reliance was placed on Haryana Telecom, which held that if you do not have the power to grant a particular relief, or the meaning the arbitral tribunal, then no question arises of the arbitral tribunal taking this, taking up such disputes. Now, in spite of this judgment of Haryana Telecom and one or two Madras High Court judgments which seem to suggest what Haryana Telecom had very explicitly held, in 2010, we had a series of cases where, again, the company law board went back and somehow seemed to ignore Haryana Hind Samachar and Haryana Telecom, and went on to hold that if the subject matter of the disputes in an operation mismanagement petition was covered by an arbitration agreement, then the mandate of the Arbitration Act required that that very dispute should be referred to arbitration. Now here, Delhi High Court actually accepted the view of the company law board. And in doing so, the Delhi High Court relied on a Supreme Court decision reported in 2008, 16 Supreme Court cases 774. I've known it as Everest case, which was actually a Section 11 petition. And in a Section 11 petition, the Supreme Court seemed to be of the view that the affairs of the company could form the subject matter of arbitral proceedings. And this is what was relied upon by the Delhi High Court. And as a matter of interest, the Supreme Court judge was also from Delhi, Justice Sharma. And the judge of the Delhi High Court is a very well-respected judge who held this, Justice Muralidhar, who's now in Punjab and Haryana High Court. But be that as it may, that's how things went. And this was, of course, while this was the position, Supreme Court also in the meantime came to decide on the issue of the forum of an appeal under Section 50 of the Arbitration and Conciliation Act, 1996. Where a application to refer under 45 had been rejected. Now, when considering that matter, it is interesting to note that the Supreme Court, by its analysis in the case, seemed to suggest, and I'll have occasion to rely on this later on when we get to solve the problem, that the affairs of a company could form the subject matter of arbitral proceedings. But more importantly, before the Supreme Court, Hind Samachar's case was cited. And Supreme Court, other than noting what had been decided there, apropos jurisdiction of entertaining an appeal, did not approve Hind Samachar, though it had an opportunity to do so, on the arbitrability issue vis-a-vis 397-398 proceedings. Now then came a decision which is cited most often these days. That is the decision in Rajendra Malhotra's case of the Bombay High Court. And this case is important. It's reported in 2015 to Company Law Journal 288. It really held a 397-398 proceedings to be an action in rem. Properly instituted proceedings would, under these provisions, would not be referable to arbitration. However, it said the judicial authority, that's the Company Law Board, now National Company Law Tribunal, before whom such a petition is filed, would have the jurisdiction to assess whether the petition before it was mala fide, vexatious, oppressive, or dressed up with a view to avoid arbitration. In other words, the real dispute was one which was squarely covered by the arbitration agreement, but an attempt had been made to avoid arbitration by window dressing the entire case. I mean, we quite often, as lawyers, we do that to a plaint. When we cannot find a cause of action, we just make it sound nice. But if all the frills are taken out, we find that really there is no case. So it's really that kind of a situation where it's the draftsman craft which kind of really conceals the real case, or seems to suggest that there is a case when there is none. So this is the case which is now, so now the test is now, it is accepted in several courts that you really can't, but not yet the Delhi High Court in those terms. Vijay Sekri's case still stands. And there is no pronouncement of the Supreme Court on the arbitrability issue directly, though passages from two decisions seem to suggest that it is arbitrable, matters relating to the affairs of a company. But what happened after this case, and slightly before that, is that the Company Law Board and then the National Company Law Tribunal have on several occasions proceeded on the basis that this issue is not arbitrable at all. And unless, of course, it can be shown that it is a dressed-up petition. Now, one instance of a dressed-up petition, and a fairly well-known one, in which I actually lost appearing for the petitioners, was the Calcom Cements case. The court held here that the complaint made petition was squarely covered by the shareholders' agreement, and the petition had been drawn up in such fashion as to dress up this real dispute and present it as one of oppression and mismanagement, and referred the parties to arbitration. The matter actually went up to the Guwahati High Court. The parties settled the matter and went to arbitration. And though it has been 3 years, that arbitration is still pending. After all, the place of arbitration is India, and the domestic tribunal is very high part. Now, thereafter, there have also been high court decisions, as well as decisions of the, as I said, National Company Law Tribunal. All of them proceed on the basis that it's not arbitrable. But significantly, there has been a decision of the appellate tribunal as well, though it seems to suggest that this issue is not arbitrable, a genuine dispute for oppression and mismanagement. It also clearly holds in one sentence that if there is in reality breach of contractual obligations, the dispute would be arbitrable. That's your Dhananjay Mishra's case. So the position as it stands today, my respectful opinion before all of you would be that an arbitration clause by itself does not exclude the jurisdiction of the National Company Law Tribunal. The law as it stands today is in a state of, if I may say so, uncertainty. Several courts have taken a divergent view. Delhi High Court seems to suggest that affairs of a company can be the subject matter of arbitral proceedings. Other courts suggest otherwise. However, the Supreme Court has not pronounced directly on the issue, but what it has said in two matters seem to suggest that the arbitral tribunal would have jurisdiction to go into the affairs of a company. Now, I just want to add one thing here. By and large, shareholder disputes are commercial disputes. There is not on the face of it, unless of course we have a case of prejudicial to public interest. There is usually these petitions are commercial disputes. In fact, courts have also held before the present provision was introduced as Section 430 of the Companies Act 2013 that There is also a common law right in seeking relief for oppression and mismanagement. It's not simply a statutory right. Like rectification of a share register has also been recognized to be a common law right. There are decisions of both, why am I saying both, of several high courts, including Calcutta, Delhi, Bombay, that an oppression, mismanagement, you can have a suit, a civil suit, based on a cause of action of oppression and mismanagement. So here we have a situation which was really a common law remedy. Statute gave that option to seek a remedy by invoking statutory provisions, maybe, and provided a scope for reliefs which were much wider than what a civil court could grant. But the dispute itself could be entertained by a civil court. And it's really, if it's a commercial dispute, really has no public element. So according to me, this aspect of the matter has been completely overlooked by the courts when holding that this is not arbitrable. And what is significant to note is there have been several Supreme Court decisions on arbitrability, starting from Booz Allen. We've had Ayaswamy, and we've had Vimal Kishore Shah on the Trust Act. We've had several on landlord-tenant matters. And a list of, or rather, an illustrative list of examples have been given. Though winding up an insolvency and bankruptcy has been included as causes of action which are not arbitrable, as far as our public policy is concerned, because third-party rights are involved. In a petition under 397, 398, that, or 241, 242, that doesn't even find mention in the illustrative list. And in most cases, an examination of the reliefs would show that really no third party is going to be affected. So this is another factor which needs to be kept in mind when deciding whether this matter is arbitrable or not. So far from defeating a proceeding under 397, 398, I'd say it depends on the facts and circumstances of the case and the issues at large. I think that's how I want to introduce the law and a bit of my thoughts on the matter. And just add one more thing, that in most jurisdictions where courts have similar powers to 241, 242, they have held that the matter can be referred to arbitration where it's a commercial dispute. And the amendments to 8 and 45, as far as arbitrability is concerned, it has really not made any difference, particularly after MR's case and Zenith's case, which talk about arbitrability still being a live issue in spite of the amendments to Section 8 and 45. Yes, the validity of the agreement is pronounced upon only on a prima facie basis and not a final basis. That is one change. But prima facie, there has to be a satisfaction that it is arbitrable as well. That's it. I don't want to dilate any further. I think I've overshot my time.
Thank you, sir. That discourse was really helpful. Now, can I request the next speaker, Dhruv, to please share his views on the topic?
Thank you. The moderator, can you hear me clearly?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, everyone. I think the authority has spoken, so and I can add very little, but let me just sort of throw in a few points of my own into this discussion pool. I think any discussion on whether an arbitration clause would operate to the exclusion of the remedy under Section 241 and 242 must consider the very unique and special jurisdiction that 241 and 242 is. In fact, many commentators have called the jurisdiction of operation and mismanagement as a sui generis jurisdiction.
Dhruv, can you please speak up a bit? Just slightly adjust your headphones and then speak up.
Okay. Is it any better now?
Yeah.
Okay, so should I start from the start or should I just...
No, you can continue.
Okay, thank you. So as I think I was only pointing out the fact that a lot of commentators have called the jurisdiction of operation mismanagement as a sui generis jurisdiction. And I believe that there are conceptual and jurisprudential reasons why, despite the existence of an arbitration clause and despite the disputes being covered by an arbitration clause, the jurisdiction of the NCLT or the erstwhile CLB under section 241, 242 or under 397, 398 must really hold its weight. And let me start delineating and setting out those reasons one by one. The first reason really lies in the historical evolution of the jurisdiction of operation mismanagement. As most of you may be aware, India has borrowed the operation and mismanagement jurisdiction from India. In fact, up till 1948, I'm sorry, there was no concept of an operation jurisdiction in England. And it was the Cohen Committee, which in 1948 said that there should be this concept of operation, which should be brought in as an exception to the rule in Foss versus Horbottle to give relief to a minority shareholder. The position before the introduction of the operation jurisdiction was that a minority shareholder who felt aggrieved by the actions of a majority could only institute a winding up petition on the basis of a just on contending that it is just and equitable to wind up. But it was largely felt that that was an inadequate remedy to the minority shareholder, because even if the minority shareholder is successful, it would only lead to the liquidation of the company and would provide no real justice to the interests of the minority shareholder. In India, back in India, the Bhabha Committee looked at the report of the Cohen Committee and said that if in England a new remedy in the form of Section 210 of the Companies Act has been introduced, we must also have the same remedy in India. And that is how we got Section 397 in India. England never had a concept of mismanagement, but the Bhabha Committee was of the opinion that we should in turn have a concept of mismanagement apart from oppression as a standalone head. And therefore, we had a corresponding Section 398 brought in to our statute book. Okay, I think I've got a comment here saying that the audio is not too good.
Dhruv, if you could hold the receiver closer to your mouth, maybe that would help.
Okay, fine. Okay, let me try and be a bit louder in any case, and I'll try and hold it as close to my mouth as possible.
Thank you.
Okay. So as I was saying, so in India, we had both 397 and 398 introduced pursuant to the Bhabha Committee report in the 1956 Act. The important point here is that in England, as also in India, it has been held that the just and equitable clause is really the heart and soul of the operation and mismanagement jurisdiction. And this comes out pursuant to a lot of decisions, both in England and in India. The leading English decision on this point is one that we are, I think, perhaps all practitioners of company law are familiar with. It's called Ibrahimi, and it's a decision of the UK House of Lords. And back in India, we've got Hanuman Prasad Bagri of the Calcutta High Court, which was affirmed by the Supreme Court. And very recently, a judgment of Justice Shagdar, sitting as a judge of the Madras High Court in Ethiraj's case. Now, all of these decisions really say that the requirement of just and equitable, that it is just that the allegations are such that it is just and equitable to wind up the company, but to do so would unfairly prejudice the complaining shareholder, is the heart and soul of our company law jurisprudence on this particular aspect. Now, what really is the requirement of just and equitable? The just and equitable requirement, actually, in my view, and subject to what Mr. Mukherjee has to say, is actually a recognition of the fact that behind the veil of a company, behind the corporate structure of a company, there are real people with real obligations, real expectations. It basically brings out the concept that the literal word written in the agreement can be superimposed with equitable consideration. And there are considerations of, in fact, the other way to see it is that there are considerations of a personal character which make it inequitable to exercise strict legal rights. Now, that is the essence of just and equitable. Now, interestingly, England has moved out of the just and equitable provision. So the new Companies Act under Section 995 no longer has the requirement of there being a just and equitable requirement. But in India, whereas the 1956 Act only had just and equitable requirement qua operation action, we have now extended it to even mismanagement actions. So what is really, according to me, the policy of the legislature seems to be a recognition of the fact that just and equitable, or rather equitable considerations, form an important segment of our company jurisprudence. So that, I believe, is the first point which is unique to this jurisdiction of 241, where strict legal rights can be superimposed, or rather can be overridden by purely equitable consideration. Now, for a moment, contrast this position with the Arbitration Act. As we all know, under Section 28(2) of the Arbitration Act, an arbitrator cannot decide matters purely on the basis of equity. In fact, for him to decide on the basis of equity, he can only do so if the parties have expressly, by agreement, asked that the matters be decided by equity. This stands in stark contrast to the jurisdiction under Section 241. The yet another very interesting feature of this jurisdiction of 241 is the fact that it is not constricted by the strict rigors of what is right and wrong. I think way back many years ago, Justice Bhagwati, sitting as a judge of the Gujarat High Court, in Sayaji Textiles case, had held that it is quite irrelevant to decide the issue of operation mismanagement, whether the act is legal or not. In fact, purely legal acts might still be considered to be oppressive, and an act which is otherwise contrary to law might not be oppressive if ultimately it benefits the company. And this dictum of Justice Bhagwati was extracted and approved in the judgment in Needle Industry. So therefore, again, the uniqueness of the jurisdiction is that it's really not based, or it's really not there to decide right and wrong, or per se right and wrong. Again, now contrast this position of law with the Arbitration Act. Associate Builder tells us that if an arbitrator has departed from the terms of the contract, if his decision is in flagrant violation of the terms of the contract, that could then afford a public policy ground to set aside the award. This again is a very distinguishing feature between the jurisdiction of 241, where considerations of equity, where considerations of operation mismanagement play a bigger role than deciding what right and wrong, where despite finding that there has been no operation, orders of buyout and sale have passed. And this again stands in contradistinction to the jurisdiction of an arbitrator deciding an arbitral matter. Then there is an issue of the reliefs which can be granted under Section 242. Mr. Mukherjee has dealt with that in some detail. The fact that the reliefs that an arbitral tribunal, that the reliefs that an arbitral tribunal can grant are limited as compared to what an NCLT or CLB can do has been a massive factor while deciding and while holding that these disputes are not arbitrable. But just for a moment, consider the broad spectrum of reliefs which can be granted by the NCLT under Section 242. You can have a buyout order. You can have a purchase order. If the buyout or the purchase order leads to a reduction of capital, even that can be passed by the NCLT. Under 242, the NCLT can in fact override the articles of a company. It can override the memorandum of a company. It can terminate contracts. It can terminate directors. It can suspend directors. It can assess damages against delinquent directors. So that really is the width of jurisdiction of the NCLT that we are talking about. And which jurisdiction is really not available with an arbitral tribunal. In some of the decided case laws, an argument has also been taken that this entire chapter, which contains Section 241, 242, and other sections, form a complete code in itself. So it is not really a restricted only Section 241 and 242. In fact, the scheme is much larger. And that scheme, for instance, encompasses Section 245, which confers the power on the NCLT to punish for its own contempts. That scheme contains a stipulation, I believe, in Section 243, which says that if the contract of a director or managing managing director has been terminated, that director or managing director will have no right to claim compensation against the company, and that person will stand debarred for a period of 5 years from again becoming a director of that company without the leave of the tribunal. There are also stipulations that in the event the NCLT has directed for the articles or a portion of the articles to be struck out or deleted, those articles cannot be brought back into the articles of that company by the company pursuant to a shareholder resolution without the leave of the tribunal. Now, all of these actually point out again in my respectful view to the fact that the jurisdiction which is being which is being exercised by NCLT is not only of a different, of a much wider amplitude, but frankly, qualitatively is of a different nature altogether. See, often when we talk about the issue of arbitration and why arbitration should be enforced, there is an argument of election which is taken. It has often been argued that the moment you insert an arbitration clause in a contract, that really amounts to an election by the party that I have to stand by my bargain of the arbitration clause and I've elected to go by to the exclusion of my other remedies. But frankly speaking, I'm not sure if that doctrine of election can ever contest shareholder disputes to be administered by the NCLT, because these two remedies frankly operate in very, very different spheres. And my last point on this section really is about the very language of Section 241. If one was to clearly and just examine the language, apart from the fact that 241 claims can lie for actions which are prejudicial to the interest of members or a class of them, or to the prejudicial to the interest of the company, there is also a public interest angle there. So a shareholder which has personally suffered no damage, who has personally suffered no injury, can actually file a litigation claiming that the actions of the company are prejudicial to the interest of public. Now, no such thing really exists in the arbitral realm, because I have not seen any case, and I doubt very much such a case will ever exist, where a person in arbitration claims that he doesn't have any relief to claim for himself, but he's only gone there to espouse a public interest issue. So all of the various arguments that I've actually spent the last few minutes on are only pointing to the fact, according to me, that there is a great weight behind the rationale and the reasoning that shareholder remedies stand on a different pedestal than remedies exercisable bar or remedies which can be given by an arbitrator deciding an arbitral dispute. There is one other issue I'd like to speak on, which is Mr. Mukherjee referred to it, the judgment of the Bombay High Court in Rakesh Malhotra. And I have some few comments to offer on that. Rakesh Malhotra is an interesting decision. And the argument of the counsels who appeared and who were resisting arbitration led by Mr. Chinoy was the fact, again, based on the judgment of the Bombay High Court in Bennett Coleman, the same argument I just said a few minutes earlier, that the reliefs which can be given by the NCLT are much wider. And therefore, you cannot have an arbitration to the exclusion of the remedy which is provided to the CLB. It was actually a case under 56 Act. So there was a CLB at that point of time. The argument of the parties seeking reference to the arbitration was that one should never look at the issue of arbitrability from the perspective of whether reliefs can be granted by the CLB or not. Because what is actually referred to arbitration is not the relief, but what is referred to arbitration is the dispute. So long as there is an arbitration clause, which is in existence and which is valid, and so long as that arbitration clause covers the disputes, the matter must be referred to arbitration. Now, Justice Gautam Patel, of course, mostly agreed with the parties who were saying that the matter should not be referred to arbitration. But as Mr. Mukherjee has pointed out, he carved out an exception. And it is with respect to the exception that I want to actually speak a few lines. The exception at the cost of repetition was that the matters which are before an CLB, and which are covered by an arbitration clause would ordinarily not be referred to arbitration unless the petition is vexatious, it is mala fide, it is an abuse of process, or it is a dressed up action to avoid the arbitration clause. Now, I have, with all due respect at my command, a few observations to make regarding this exception that he has carved out. Firstly, it's actually not very clear upon reading of the judgment whether the application of this test of mala fide, vexatious, dressed up, has to be examined on a prima facie basis or has to be examined on the basis of a thorough investigation of the merits of the matter. Section 8 and Section 85, Section 45, both postulate a prima facie test. So before a judicial authority and when it has to refer a matter to arbitration, under Section 8, a prima facie examination has to be seen whether there is the arbitration clause. Likewise, under Section 45, a prima facie examination has to be seen or made of the fact that whether the arbitration clause is null, void, inoperative, or incapable of being performed. But when it comes to this particular test of being vexatious or mala fide or dressed up, it is not very clear whether that has to be undertaken on a prima facie basis or whether the NCLT will really have to go deep down into the merits of the matter to try and figure out whether it is mala fide, etc., or not. Now, be that as it may, besides this point, according to me, even the barest examination of the contents of an NCLT petition to see whether it is mala fide, whether it is dressed up, whether it is vexatious, would actually lead to an inquiry into looking at the allegations in the petition, trying to see whether oppression or prejudice is made out, trying to see the law that whether these allegations, if found to be true, will amount to oppression or prejudice under law, and whether the release can be granted or not. I think there is an imminent risk of a mini trial happening there, because though the test seems to be a very easy one, vexatious, etc., but its practical application, there is really a possibility that it will lead to a mini trial at the level of an NCLT even before referring the matter to arbitration. And this problem, frankly, will get compounded by the fact that both in cases covered by Section 8 and 45, typically the defendant or the respondent would file the application without filing his reply, because that has to be the first step in the proceeding. So this examination will take place only on the basis of the petition as it stands, and perhaps on the basis of the application under Section 8 or 45 as the case may be. There would not be even a proper reply which would have been filed to the petition or to the suit as the case may be. So I think Mr. Mukherjee is right when he says that the law is perhaps far from clear at this point of time. The state of the law is also slightly in flux. We are not very clear. Rakesh Malhotra does provide us a very useful tool in deciding whether a matter should be referred to arbitration or not. But as I said, at least in my respectful submission, it is really not the most ideal test. And if I've got like two more minutes, I just need to speak a bit more. The moderators, can I just speak for 2 more minutes?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
Yeah. Okay. So I think before I sort of end, Mr. Mukherjee did refer to some case law of foreign jurisdictions. And just one interesting sort of a comment here. Rakesh Malhotra was decided, I think, in August of 2014. And almost a little over a year later, the Singapore High Court, the Singapore Court of Appeals, which is the highest court in Singapore, had the occasion to decide this very same issue in a case called Tomlinson Holdings versus Silica Investor. And that's a very interesting decision. And if ever one was to contrast the findings of the Singapore High Court versus the findings reached by Justice Patel in Rakesh Malhotra, the difference actually is quite stark. Because what the Singapore Court of Appeal holds is, one, that there is really no public element in a shareholder matter. So therefore, there is no public policy is breached by simpliciter referring a shareholder dispute to the arbitration tribunal. The other interesting observation, which again stands in stark contrast to Rakesh Malhotra, is that the finding that just because the arbitration tribunal does not have the full arsenal of remedies which a court exercising a jurisdiction akin to NCLT possesses, does not mean that the matter should not be referred to arbitration. So the view of the Singapore Court of Appeals was that the issue of grant of relief is very different from the issue of arbitration. And the Singapore Court of Appeals also referred to decisions across various jurisdictions, Canada, New Zealand, Australia, almost all Commonwealth jurisdictions, including England, where it has been held that ordinary all these matters can be sent for arbitration. Now, some commentators back home in India have said that the reason why in Singapore and UK shareholder actions have been found to be arbitrable, while the position is opposite in India, is the fact that there are structural differences between the law in Singapore and the law in India. And two such structural differences have been pointed out. The first difference is that in India, if a Section 8 and Section 45 is allowed, there is really nothing left for the court or the judicial authority to decide. Because by allowing the Section 8 or 45, the matter is being referred to arbitration and the underlying petition is disposed of. And this is very different from England and Singapore, where even after referring the parties to arbitration, the matter is only stayed before judicial authority. So if the parties can finish the arbitration and come back after the arbitration is over before the court for seeking reliefs which the arbitration tribunal cannot grant. So therefore, that is a difference in law between India and Singapore. The other reason for perhaps, which perhaps explains the change of the difference in the views between India, Singapore, and England is that in Singapore, in both Singapore and England, there is the concept of a bifurcation of case is recognized. In India, we are still struggling with the fact whether Sukanya holds the field or not. In fact, perhaps the dominant view right now, at least that's what the Andhra Pradesh High Court, Gujarat High Court, Delhi High Court seems to believe, that even after the amendment to Section 8, Sukanya has not been overruled. So therefore, the possibility of bifurcation of a single existing action doesn't exist in law. The position is opposite in England and Singapore. The position there is, and which is what the Singapore Court of Appeals did, if it found that certain matters in the shareholder action were covered by the arbitration agreement. So it referred those matters which were covered by the shareholders agreement or covered by the arbitration clause to arbitration while keeping the balance matters with itself. So therefore, perhaps these two reasons are the reasons which perhaps sort of help us in understanding why in India we still believe the predominant view still seems to be that these matters should not be referred to arbitration, and while the view in other commonwealth jurisdiction is a bit different than this. I think that's all I want to say.
Thank you, Dhruv, for sharing your views and giving us the differences in the different jurisdictions in England and Singapore versus India. And I take it that your view on the issue is also that arbitration clause per se does not exclude the NCLT jurisdiction. In addition to the couple of reasons that Mr. Mukherjee gave, you have also cited these additional reasons.
Yes, I think pretty much it cannot as a matter of law. I think unless, in my view, the most workable test actually is the test that is available to us in the form of Rakesh Malhotra. But if otherwise on looking at the petition, the NCLT is of the view that the petition is, say, one for enforcement of rights under a contract, and it is really nothing to do with the exercise of rights as a shareholder under law, nothing to do with equitable considerations, nothing to do with the reliefs under 242, then this would be a proper matter to be referred to arbitration. But more or less, I think clever drafting will ensure that whenever a NCLT petition is filed, the lawyers dress up their petition in a way that it in 9 out of 10 cases, the reference to arbitration might become very difficult.
Thank you, Dhruv, for that. Okay. Now we come to the last segment of this session, where Mr. Mukherjee will summarize the legal position on this issue and share his practical insights on how to get around for the shareholder or for the company. Over to you, sir.
So the summing up is actually that it is an arbitration clause per se does not exclude the jurisdiction of the NCLT. I think we should all be very clear on that. If we look at a shareholders agreement, we see an arbitration clause that per se by itself cannot, but we certainly need to examine what the actual issues are before we advise our client to take one step or the other. Now, here I just want to get on to what would one look at to decide what would be the appropriate proceedings to institute. So I want to basically break it up into a couple of situations, or maybe 4 or 5 situations. So if the real dispute, which you as a lawyer or the draftsman identify as one of breach of a particular provision of the shareholders agreement, and it's a one-time breach, the best thing to do would be that if that is what the client is complaining of, go to arbitration. So this is whether it's a foreign seated arbitration or Indian seated arbitration. This is one extreme. Then we have a situation where we have the articles, we have a shareholders agreement, maybe shareholders agreement, parts of it or the entirety of it is incorporated in the articles. And we have the shareholder coming and telling his lawyers, look, we've had these documents in place, but this is how I have been treated over a period of time. says companies' funds have been misused, siphoned, secret profits have been made. Satellite companies belonging to one group have been utilized as conduits to make this, to have fictitious transactions to make these funds available ultimately to the other group. And reliefs are also sought against persons who've been party to such wrongdoings. And there are statutory violations, breach of fiduciary duties, conflict situations, breach of the articles. And the shareholder comes and tells you that maybe there's a breach of shareholders' agreements. But I am looking at it not as simply a breach. I look at it as a lack of morality in business dealing. I look at the agreement as a piece of as an understanding, whether enforceable or not, which would subject all legal rights to equitable considerations. That is the duty to act with utmost good faith, because most of these are closely held companies where you have these kind of disputes with arbitration clauses. There's not been commercial probity. There's a course of conduct which is really sought to freeze me out of the business. I don't want to go out, but it's seeking to freeze me out. Then I would suggest a operation mismanagement petition. Whether companies are party to the shareholders agreement or not, I would straight away suggest this. Now, what is also important is to examine who the parties are. If in reality the agreement is between two groups and the parties who are being arrayed are all members of the same group, then you can't say that merely because I have more parties who are not parties to the arbitration agreement, we can avoid an arbitration. We must bear that in mind when doing, advising client. Because courts have now gone on to hold, in spite of Sukanya, they said that if the party is not a necessary party, or we can see a twist at it to a cause of action, or a unnecessary adding of parties to avoid arbitration, then we will not prevent arbitration from taking place. We shall act in such manner so as to have the disputes resolved by arbitration. That's been the court's view, and Calcutta High Court has about 6 judgments on this. So I think this is one factor which needs to be borne in mind. And then the reliefs. Now, as Dhruv also pointed out, what is important to remember that the relief which an arbitral tribunal can grant, the NCLT can grant, is not limited to what has been sought. And in fact, it might not grant any of those reliefs, but grant what the NCLT might feel would, quote unquote, bring to an end the matters complained of. 242(2) are only illustrative. The real exercise of jurisdiction is to bring to an end the matters complained of. In other words, end the oppression, end the acts which are prejudicial to the interest of the company. And it has to, it's a breakdown machinery which has to provide for relief once and for all, not create a situation where the same thing will repeat itself, which is why the buyout or sellout is such a common remedy, that the person who's complaining, his oppression is taken care of. The oppression is ended. There is no further scope for, after things are put back, to again be oppressed, because it doesn't benefit the company either. But keeping all this in mind, one must remember that in reality today, commercial disputes, it is encouraged, should go to arbitration if there is an arbitration clause. That's the mindset. It's very easy for a tribunal to say that, look, I find your petition window dressed. For one, it could be a situation that a breach of contract is also an oppressive act. It's not that it cannot be, But the courts will look at it only as a pure and simple breach of contract where you've agreed to have that issue resolved by arbitration. So when drafting, I think you have to have a very good case of oppression and mismanagement. And where there are, if particularly if there, and you have a good chance, particularly where the actors are persons who are also not parties to the arbitration agreement, who are actually all necessary parties, so that you can fall into Sukanya. But I think a third thing also needs to be borne in mind, and we have on a number of occasions faced this in litigation. It is this, that if it's a foreign seated arbitration, we need to examine what is the lex arbitri. In other words, what is the issue of arbitrability in that jurisdiction? Because what can happen there in the other jurisdiction is, like in Singapore, as Dhruv was indicating to us, a shareholder dispute can go to arbitration. Now, if you have a Singapore-seated arbitration, the first thing you'll have is an anti-suit or anti-oppression mismanagement proceeding. You'll get an injunction on that, and you will be asked to appear in Singapore. The arbitration will be commenced there, and it will go on. And even if there is no anti-suit, both will go on. And in all likelihood, it will be a race vis-a-vis both the proceedings. It's another matter with regard to enforceability. Because then the issue will arise whether the award is enforceable in India or not, but elsewhere it could be. So you have to keep that in mind. Am I, by filing a 397, 390, actually, or a 241, 242, ultimately not going to get anywhere? Because the other party can go for arbitration and get to enforce or execute the award against me. So this aspect also needs to be kept in mind, and I'm not going to say too much on what one needs to take care of while drafting, but I have one suggestion to make. It is not a bad idea today to also have an alternate prayer for winding up if you don't want to go to arbitration. Because a joint petition is maintainable. You can always have an alternate case for winding up. And that's what was decided in Margaret Dessau, that the averments which have to be made for a company to be wound up on just and equitable grounds is not destructive of a case of oppression and mismanagement. That's the exact language of Margaret Dessau. And it's common, because in England, and 210, including the famous Ibrahimi case, there was an alternate prayer for winding up. It was a 210 with a prayer for purchase, and alternate was winding up. And it's the alternate relief which was granted. So if you do have a good case, I would suggest you go for oppression and mismanagement with an alternate prayer for winding up. And if public interest is involved, then, of course, according to me, unless, again, it's a dressed-up public interest, the issue of arbitrability will be a clear answer to going to arbitration, that you cannot be sent to arbitration on public issues at all. Because that's not what a private forum is meant for. It, in fact, may not be a commercial dispute at all then. I think that's where we'll keep the summing up and the appropriate remedy. And I think I've given enough tips on drafting, but I'm happy to take further questions on that. So we get on to the most exciting bit of today's webinar, which is the problem on which Mr. Dhruv Diwan has worked very hard.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mukherjee, for summing it up. In fact, I do have a question, but I'll keep that question for the question-answer session on a fourth scenario, which might be helpful for all practitioners. But moving on, now I would like to request Reena to start the second segment of the topic, which is the case problem.
Thanks, Rohan. So we have worked out a mock case scenario, which is also being put up on the screen for everyone's benefit. Now, this case problem is a blend of different realities according to us. So I'll first read out the case and will then invite our speakers to address their arguments on the issues. A is a tech billionaire in the e-commerce space. A's longtime friend B runs a successful pharmaceuticals and drug business. A and B get their kids married. This alliance paves way for A and B to form a new joint venture company, JVC, to operate an online pharmacy, www.getyourmed.com. A and B hold 51% and 49% shares respectively in the JVC. Under the JV agreement, A and B are entitled to appoint 4 directors each on the board of the JVC, with the day-to-day management vesting in a professional MD to be appointed jointly by A and B. The JV agreement has an arbitration clause which provides for resolution of all disputes between A and B, howsoever arising, through arbitration in New Delhi. The JV is a party to the JVC is a party to the JV agreement. Now, X, who is a close friend of A, is appointed as the MD and chairman of JVC. X manages the day-to-day business and has a casting vote in the board of 9 directors. The JVC enters into a long-term drug supply agreement of 15 years, DSA, with B's company, which is B Plus, which is 100% owned and controlled by B, to purchase drugs. Under the DSA, JVC has an obligation to offtake certain minimum quantities of drugs every year, failing which the JVC is liable to pay liquidated damages. DSA 2 has a widely worded arbitration clause. In late 2019, the kids of A and B separate. This strains the relationship of A and B. In March 2020, even as India grapples with COVID-19, A and B start sparring. B's nominee directors object to the board's proposal to donate a sum of rupees 50 crores to the PM CARES Fund. However, the same is approved by majority since X uses his casting vote. Now, B then commissions a forensic report which implicates X in serious financial bungling. A and X reject the report as self-serving, without the board's authority, and even otherwise meritless. In a board meeting in the last week of April 2020, board of JVC by majority terminates the DSA, citing irregularities and onerous conditions. Now, B's nominee directors oppose the decision in the board meeting, but as it becomes clear that they would be outvoted, they stage a walkout from the board meeting. After the walkout, the board resolves to sign a DSA with D, who is a competitor of B Plus and an alleged friend of X, to supply drugs to the JVC, and authorizes X to release advance payment to D. There are also certain unverifiable media reports that B may be brought in as a strategic investor in the JVC. Now, B files a petition under Section 241-242 against A, nominee directors of A, X, and D, alleging oppression, mismanagement of JVC. The petition alleges oppression of B's proprietary rights as shareholder of JVC, wrongful termination of contract with B+, and financial irregularities by X based on the forensic report. B inter alia seeks reliefs of removal of X as the MD of JVC, appointment of an administrator, cancellation of B's agreement, and restoration of contract with B+. A and JVC make an application under Section 8 for reference of the disputes to arbitration under the JV agreement and DSA with B+, respectively. Now, Mr. Mukherjee would be advancing his arguments on behalf of parties A and JVC, who are seeking reference to arbitration, and Dhruv will be opposing reference to arbitration on behalf of party B. Now, normally in a case scenario like this, it is usually the respondent who is seeking reference to arbitration who would begin his arguments first. But here, in order to save time and to avoid rejoinder submissions, we would first invite Dhruv to advance his arguments first, opposing reference to arbitration, and then Mr. Mukherjee would respond. Dhruv?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Can you hear me now? There was some problem in hearing me initially.
Yeah.
Okay. So let me start my submissions by saying that if there was ever any doubt on the legal issue of whether shareholder actions can be referred to arbitration, that doubt has now resolved by the advent of the Companies Act 2013 and by dint of the fact that the Arbitration and Conciliation Act has been amended. And I say so for the reason, as a matter of law, therefore, that shareholder actions can now not be referred to arbitration at all. The reason, and there are three good reasons for that, all based on subsequent legal events. One, that Section 430 has been brought in the Companies Act. Section 430 gives exclusive jurisdiction to the NCLT and to the Arbitral Tribunal to look into issues under the Companies Act to the exclusion of the civil court. And that inclusion of Section 430 shows the overriding legislative intent that the tribunal should continue to hear and adjudicate upon these matters. Secondly, and actually just on the first point again, a provision like Section 430 was not there in the Companies Act 1956. It has only been brought out in the Companies Act 2013. The second reason is that, which again shows the legislative intent for these matters to carry on, is the retention of the requirement of just and equitable in Section 241 of the Act, and extension of the requirement insofar as mismanagement actions are concerned. Now, the current Section 241 is an amalgamation of the earlier Sections 397 and 398. As I said a few minutes back, earlier the requirement was of just and equitable only existed for actions of oppression, and now the requirement is also for actions of mismanagement. So the fact that the legislature has extended the requirement of just and equitable to mismanagement, retained it for oppression, also shows the fact that the legislature does want the NCLT to decide shareholder matters with an equitable bent of mind, and therefore those matters should preserve and should stay with the NCLT. The third reason is that when the Companies Act, when the new Companies Act was brought about, and when the Arbitration Act, Section 8 especially, was being amended, at that point of time, the legislature was indeed aware of the state of law as it existed, including pronouncements by various high courts that shareholder matters will ordinarily not be referred to arbitration. Despite that, there were no express changes made to Section 8 suggesting that arbitration is now going to outvote or rather override the shareholder remedy. On the contrary, Section 2(3) of the Arbitration Conciliation Act stays as it is. And if I may quote, that reads that this part shall not affect any other law for the time being in force, by virtue of which certain disputes may not be submitted to arbitration. Now, the Supreme Court, in the matter of MRFGF, which was the matter where the Supreme Court decided that consumer matters cannot be forcibly sent to arbitration, has opined on Section 2(3) and has clearly laid down that Section 2(3) shows that the Arbitration Act, the issue of arbitrability under the Arbitration Act, is subservient to other legislation which makes certain matters, keep certain matters out of the purview of arbitration. So therefore, the Supreme Court judgment in the case of MRFGF, the inclusion of Section 430, the fact that there is nothing expressed even after the amendment to the Arbitration Act, keeping shareholder disputes out of the way of arbitration, are all clear pointers to the fact that as a matter of law, shareholder disputes can never be sent to arbitration. Now, my second submission in the alternative to the first one, and assuming I am wrong on the first submission, is that assuming that certain shareholder matters on a case-to-case basis can be referred to arbitration, then the true test really is a test which has been laid down by the Bombay High Court in the case of Rakesh Malhotra. And that test is very simple. The test is the matter will be kept by the NCLT unless it finds a dispute to be vexatious, mala fide, or a dressed-up action. Now, the inquiry at that point of time is never on the prospect of success of the NCLT petition or whether the petitioner before the NCLT will eventually get the relief. The only inquiry at that point of time is whether it is a genuine shareholder action ventilating genuine shareholder grievances or not. And so long as it is a genuine shareholder action, the matter should never be referred to arbitration. And my submission is that whether or not it's a genuine shareholder action, must be decided on the same basis that a civil court decides an application under Order 7, Rule 11, which is to keep the contents of the plaint in mind, not to look at what the respondent is saying, but assuming on a plea of demurrer that whatever is stated in the plaint is correct, if a cause of action is made out, then the suit is proceeded with. Likewise, if on reading of my petition it becomes clear that I am raising a genuine shareholder matter, the NCLT must then keep the matter with itself and not refer the matter to arbitration. Now, looking at the complaints that I have made out in my petition, it will become absolutely clear beyond any shred of doubt that I actually indeed, which is party B, actually indeed does have a genuine shareholder action of which he is aggrieved by the actions of the respondent. Now, if one was to look at the facts of this case, and the following will become clear. The foundation of the relationship between A and B was mutual trust arising out of a familiar relationship of a very close nature. They were friends to begin with. Later on, when their kids got married, they decided to launch a new company. And the fact that there was mutual trust between each other is clear from the fact that they almost held equal shareholding in the JV company, and that the appointment of the person who will run the company, which is the CEO or the MD as the case may be, was actually left to be jointly decided by them. All these stipulations show the extent of mutual respect and the mutual trust for each other. That trust and confidence now has broken down owing to a series of actions which have been undertaken at A or at the behest of A by X. This is not a singular isolated incident that we have come to NCLT for. If you look at the case problem, it is actually quite sort of clear that there are a series of actions of which I am aggrieved. Now, these actions consist of taking very important decisions without consulting the nominee directors of B on the board. So a contribution of 50 crores, which is a very hefty amount, was made without properly tabling the matter, without proper deliberation on the board of the company. The board of the company has refused to look at very serious allegations of misdemeanors, financial irregularities at the behest of X, which all point out to prejudice to the interests of the JV company. The least the board should have done is to have looked at the forensic report and then to have taken suitable action, or perhaps verified those reports to a third party, but that has also not been considered. Then a long-term DSA agreement, which was supposed to be for 15 years, has been terminated only out of vindictiveness and spite towards B. That again is an action which is prejudicial to the interest of the company, which is prejudicial to my interest, because when we came together to form the JV company, it was on the understanding that my company, which is B Plus, will continue to have the rights to supply drugs to the JV company for a long period of time. Now, all these actions have been done by the majority. They have been done against B, who is not in management, and have been done to harass B. The other feature of the case on fact is that X, who is de facto in management of the company, he's acting in a partisan manner, he's siding with B, and therefore the trust which is expected, the trust that we have on the management, has now been completely betrayed. Now, therefore, by all of these facts, it is quite clear that the affairs of the company are being conducted in a manner which is prejudicial to its interest, to my interest, and also to public interest, because ultimately healthcare has been held to be a fundamental right. The right to healthcare is a right which is protected by Article 21. So therefore, there is a public interest angle also in the allegations that we have made in our petition before the NCLT. And there is absolutely no doubt that the facts in this case justify the making of a winding up order, but the making of such a winding up order on just and equitable grounds will greatly prejudice me because of my valuable investment in this company. I am therefore seeking the following relief from the tribunal. There should be restrictions on the transfer or allotment of shares of the JV company, because we anticipate that my competitor, B's competitor D, now might be brought in as a shareholder in this company. X should be removed as a director. The new DSA with D should be terminated, and the erstwhile DSA with B Plus should be restored. There should be an investigation. They should be looking into the various allegations of financial bungling, etc., against X. And given that the MD has to be appointed jointly in joint consultation between A and B, and because there is a deadlock and we are at loggerheads with each other, the NCLT should now step in the situation and devise a way in which the new MD should be appointed, or devise a way in which the management of this company should be run, so that there is the business can be done smoothly and effectively. Now, in my submission, I believe that it is only the NCLT which can grant all these reliefs. If you bifurcate this particular petition into two arbitrations, one arbitration under the JV agreement and one arbitration under the DSA, it would just lead to multiplication of litigation. It will lead to one consolidated action being dealt with by two forums who will not have the benefit of looking at this entire series of acts and the entire series of conspiracy which has been hatched against me. And therefore, I would ultimately submit to the tribunal that Mr. Mukherjee, the application moved by Mr. Mukherjee's client, should be dismissed with, as we call it, exemplary cause.
Can I come in?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
An argument without any basis on facts. So let me now just start straight away with the arbitrability issue. I presume with the seat shown as Delhi, the company probably has its registered office in Delhi. And the petition has been filed before NCLT Delhi. Can I make that assumption? And since yes, Delhiites have drafted this.
Sure, sir.
Okay.
Now, thanks for that concession, because the Delhi High Court, in the decision of Vijay Sekri and Union of India, 163 company cases, page 195, categorically held, relying on the Supreme Court decision in Everest Holding, that the arbitrator can exercise powers of, can go into the affairs of the company. And the express argument raised on behalf of the company, petitioner in that case, that matters could not be gone into by the arbitrator, the matters which were before the company law board, because the arbitrator didn't have powers to grant reliefs as envisaged under Everest, basically held that a arbitral tribunal may have no power to wind up, but can adjudicate on the affairs of the company. In fact, if I may use a quote from there, this is 2008, 16 Supreme Court cases, 774. The Supreme Court held, the arbitrator can always find out and adjudicate as to whether or not a company is functional. And if it was not functional, in that event, he could always find out the nature and status of its assets and can also issue directions and pass orders regarding dues and liabilities, and also for taking recourse to appropriate remedy. This was construed in by the Delhi High Court in a case involving the arbitrability of matters of oppression and mismanagement in Vijay Sekri's case, where the Delhi High Court categorically held that the complete answer to this argument was in this very passage, which I've read out from Everest. So, and mind you, 397 at that point of time required as a condition precedent for grant of relief for the just and equitable conditions to be met. So it makes no difference today whether mismanagement also has just and equitable, keeping in mind that just and equitable conditions had to be fulfilled as a precondition. The Delhi High Court categorically held that the matter could be decided by an arbitrator. Now, not only that, in Sumitomo's case, the Supreme Court again held that, or it's suggested, and I'll read out the passage, that if a company was a party to an arbitration agreement, then matters concerning its affairs could go to arbitration. And composition of a board, and I would extend it here, any dispute as to the functioning of any board member is an affair of the company. And here the company is a party to the arbitration agreement, and therefore the affairs of a company can be gone into arbitral proceedings. And in fact, the Supreme Court noted Sudarshan Chopra's case, but did not approve it. It could have, but did not approve it. And instead wanted the correctness of the decision of the company law board in not referring the parties to arbitration to be actually tested before the appropriate appellate forum. And Sumitomo's case, as I said, is 2008, four Supreme Court cases, page 91 at para 21 and 22. And I'll just read out the passage from there. It says, as rightly observed by CLB, proceedings under so-and-so always relates to the affairs of the company. And so far as the arbitration clause in JVA is to bind the company, it has to be a party to arbitration agreement. And then it goes on to say that a perusal of the agreement shows that arbitration clause has provided for resolution of disputes through arbitration, classifying the company or PTL as one party and Mazda or Sumitomo as another. In other words, no arbitration has been envisaged in JVA if dispute arises with reference to terms of service. It is relevant to mention that provisions under can be invoked only if disputes, even among shareholders or allegations, again, relate to the affairs of the company. So if the company is a party, it's suggesting, then it could have been referred to arbitration. Now, mere fact that section 430 has been introduced makes no difference at all. Because in my respectful submission, it does not take away from the fact that the jurisdiction to decide a particular issue as to whether there's oppression or mismanagement was already available as a common law remedy. It's not something which is created by statute. Oppression, mismanagement were all well-known exceptions to the Fosena bottle rule. And therefore, to say that now 430, you have to go and file it there is basically for the purpose of reducing the load before a civil court. It's got nothing to do with any public interest or socio-economic welfare legislation. In fact, I'm glad that Mr. Diwan has referred to MR's judgment, because in MR's judgment, it is clearly noted that Consumer Act is a beneficial legislation enacted to give an additional remedy for settlement of disputes. The same cannot be taken away by Section 8. And why was it additional? Because a consumer is an insignificant entity compared to the service provider. So, for a speedy resolution, they were given this additional remedy so that you don't have to go through a rigmarole of a civil suit in a court which could take you years. It's to provide them an additional remedy that this was introduced. It was socially beneficial, which is why the complaint can also be by a consumer organization taking up the cause of a consumer. The Companies Act, as far as shareholder disputes are concerned, it has got nothing to do with this. And lastly, arbitrability has been the subject matter of so many Supreme Court decisions. Booz Allen, Ayaswamy, Vimal Kishore Shah, MR, Zenith, none of them have referred to oppression or mismanagement, which are private commercial disputes between shareholders. None of them have referred to that being actually barred on account of arbitrability as an issue which can be raised before the arbitral tribunal. So in my respectful submission, the arbitrability as per Delhi High Court judgment, it is possible. Here, company is a party. If the subject matter of the agreement actually covers the subject matter of the 241, 242 petition, then of course the matter can be referred to arbitration. Now I come to the facts of the case. Now, three very important facts. There is paragraph 11 of the note which has been handed up, or the bullet point 11, is what are the three allegations which have been made the basis for grant of relief. First is that's the penultimate bullet point. Oppression of B's proprietary rights as a shareholder of JVC. Second, wrongful termination of contract with B plus. And third, financial irregularities by X based on the forensic report. So these are the three bases. Now, what is the position here? Admittedly, there is an arbitration agreement in the joint venture agreement. It is part of the joint venture agreement, which would relate to shareholder rights, management rights, everything. And I think that's a reasonable assumption to make. Then there is admittedly an arbitration agreement contained in the drug supply agreement, which deals with supply of drugs for a particular period by B plus to the joint venture company. Now, let us take first the wrongful termination of the contract with B plus. Now, on that basis, two sets of relief have been sought: that you cancel the agreement with D and you restore the agreement with B plus. In other words, the termination is bad. Now, the first point I wish to make here is, number one, this is a purely contractual dispute. The termination of the contract by the company and B plus. Clear case of a contractual dispute. Second, unless he succeeds in the contractual dispute, there's no question of cancellation of D's contract. Third, now D's contract, B should have known, and he knows, but he's clearly added that as a prayer to try and avoid arbitration, because D's contract cannot be challenged in a 241-242. It's a statutory bar. So at least the conditions, if not a bar, the conditions have not been met. And I'll draw your attention straight away to section 242-2E. Section 242-2E. It says, without prejudice to the generality of the powers under subsection 1, an order under that subsection may provide for, and kindly have a look at F, termination, setting aside, or modification of any agreement between company and any other person other than those referred to in clause E, provided that no such agreement shall be terminated, set aside, or modified except after due notice and after obtaining the consent of the party concerned. Where is D's consent here? This has just been trumped up, introduced to try and avoid arbitration, because D, it would be argued, is not a party to this arbitration agreement. It's trying to get in a party who is not even, without his consent, no relief can be granted. It's clearly trumped up. Now I come to the case of oppression. Oppression, B's proprietary rights as a shareholder. Now none have been infringed. No rights as a shareholder have been infringed. Shareholding remains at 49%. Nominee directors remain. No affirmative vote, no veto, no reserved matter. Nothing. There's no resolution against any of these, contrary to the joint venture agreement. Nothing at all. So even if there were these special rights which B might have had as a shareholder under a joint venture, as is very common, none of these, there's no allegation to that effect. And that mere fact that D might come in and make an investment, where is a presumption that this investment will be invited without complying with a law or without there being a need for such investment? There's no such averment. And yet, it's dressed up to suggest that now you please grant me relief with regard to transfer and allotment of shares. This is not only is it not covered by, is it a genuine oppression mismanagement? It is drafted in a fashion, or a case is being sought to be made out in a fashion so as to avoid arbitration. Now, X, there's an allegation that X has diverted funds. Allegation is made by B, he has some evidence in support. Company is not accepting it. The majority shareholder is not accepting it. Now, X has been added. X is not required to be added at all. This is again a management issue relating to the affairs of a company. Because if the arbitral tribunal finds that no, X has actually defalcated, it can issue a direction to both the company as well as the majority shareholder A that you pass a resolution for his removal. You cannot have this kind of consent. Consent has been based on trust, which is now, man has shown that he is incapable of all this. Then this CSR or this PM case, it's this is grievances only of being outvoted. It's not a genuine oppression petition. Nothing has been said that giving of this donation has caused any prejudice to the company. In fact, on the face of it, as we know the law, this would have benefited the company. A CSR obligation would have been met and income tax benefit would have obtained in favor of the company. So, and nominees have been made parties. Now it's well settled now that if you have nominees, then nominees are also bound by the arbitration agreement. So the entire effort here has been to trump up a case of oppression when there is none on the face of it. Second, add parties who are not necessary for the purpose of adjudication of the dispute. And then add parties against whom you can get no relief without their consent. Solely to show that I cannot be sent to arbitration. When to get to that stage itself, you in arbitration will have to succeed against the joint venture company. So this is really absolutely trumped up petition. These contractual issues in any event of the matter cannot be gone into in matters of oppression and mismanagement. And there are two decisions of the Supreme Court which cover this, and they are in CableNet and Haldia. That's 2010 6 Supreme Court cases 719 and 2011 volume 10 Supreme Court cases 466. It is a completely contractual dispute. On the face of it, it is a commercial dispute. There is no element of a public law involved here. And this bogey of Article 21, I mean, I don't know where that is coming from. There is no allegation that drugs which are being supplied by D are unfit for consumption or they are too costly. They are being sold above the rate fixed by the drug authorities. Nothing. And now we have, because you deal in pharmaceuticals, there is an Article 21 issue here, right to life is involved. Nobody is saying that no supplies are being made. There's no such allegation. There is no allegation that the price which is being charged is making it, there's some kind of profiteering involved or any government regulations are being flouted. None at all. In fact, the reliefs claimed and the parties who have been added as parties here have been done with the sole purpose of trying to avoid arbitration. And I think I'll end there. The application should instead be allowed with exemplary costs.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. And thanks, Dhruv, also for those very practical and compelling arguments from both sides. Since we do not have a judge here, we will leave the final outcome to be decided by the attendees. Now, moving to our last segment, which is our question and answer segment. I think we have already overshot time, but Rohan, can you please take up a couple of questions?
Sure, thank you, Reena. I think we have many good questions, but let me combine a few. And the first question is actually for Mr. Mukherjee. Sir, you spoke about two instances. Where the first instance is being where commercial interests are involved and parties should be encouraged to go to arbitration. And the second scenario where the interests of the company or the affairs of the company are involved and therefore the appropriate remedy should be the NCLT. Can you visualize or what advice would you give in a third scenario where a shareholder wants to agitate its grievances both before the arbitral tribunal as well as the NCLT jurisdiction? And if so, how would you consider a Section 8 application which seeks to bifurcate these causes of action between the arbitral tribunal as well as the NCLT? In other words, can both these remedies be pursued together?
Yes, so I'll respond straight away. If an arbitration has already started on a particular issue, certainly a 241 would be maintainable and will not face a maintainability issue straight away if it is based on other matters which are not the subject matter of arbitration. Second, there have been cases where both arbitration as well as 241, 242 petitions have proceeded together, where in fact there have been commonality of issues in the sense the event in one case has been described as a breach of contract and the event in another before the NCLT has been described as an act of oppression. It has happened and it has been a race to the finish. One of them was Vikram Bakshi's case where both proceedings went on and the other was your Gautam Kapoor and Limrose. That's part of the Atlas litigation. Atlas, the cycle manufacturing company litigation. So it has happened, but there is a risk here, of course, that if before the arbitration, the concerned party files a 241, 242, though it could have gone to arbitration, or he later goes and files arbitration, it might be said that the agreement is, arbitration agreement is no longer operative because he's waived his right. He had the right to go to arbitration. He didn't go to arbitration. Instead, he filed another proceeding and yet subsequently he's trying to take it to arbitration. I hope that deals with whatever issues you had.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for that answer. Now, because we have limited time, I just have the opportunity to ask one question. And that last question can be fielded by the other speaker. Dhruv, there's a question by Mr. Aditya Nair. And the question is this. It's a big question, so I'll read it out. It concerns the problem, I assume. It says, will your view change in case of an international commercial arbitration where the governing law is also foreign law? While adjudicating a petition, will the NCLT not see that CLORO controls allow parties to be added in an international arbitration? Also, the reliefs which can be granted by a foreign seated tribunal would be governed by that foreign law.
Okay, so if you can hear me, I think firstly, my view won't change. I've been paid by B to argue his case, so I'm going to argue his case. My view will not change. But having said that, I think the bulk of the arguments that at least I had in mind for B were concerning the fact that no matter where the seat of the arbitration is going to be, this is one unified petition seeking a host of reliefs concerning the derogation of rights of B as a shareholder of the JV company. So it doesn't really matter where the seat is, what the governing law of the arbitration is, because I am aggrieved by certain actions which have been done by A. And I have a remedy under the law which is given to me, 242, 241, which is completely made out in these facts. Therefore, I'm going to exercise my statutory remedy to claim relief. So that is the choice. I thought those are perhaps the arguments to make. Now, assuming, like Mr. Mukherjee argued, the opposition from the other side or the counsels who are appearing for seeking reference or supporting the reference to arbitration were to argue that there is a foreign law involved, the seat is outside India, and therefore the matter should be referred to arbitration. At least in my submission, it doesn't really matter to the issue of reference to arbitration whether the seat is outside India or within India, frankly. At least that's the way I look at it. The test is only a little different because there is a difference in the language of Section 8 and 45. Okay. So if it is a Section 8 application, the legal test is a bit different. You have to see the existence of argument. If it is a 45, the test is going to be null, void, inoperative, incapable performance, etc. But those are the arguments on testing whether an 8 and 45 lie or not. My arguments to resist the arbitration are more on the public policy front, more on the front that this remedy must be kept within Indian court, and that's the Indian tribunal. And that's the tribunal which can do substantial justice to the case of my client, which is B. I think I'll leave it at that.
I think thank you, Dhruv, for that detailed response. I hope that addresses the query of the attendee. I'm so sorry, we have overshot our time. So we will have to conclude this last session of the webinar today. And I take this opportunity to thank Mr. Mukherjee and Dhruv for sparing their time today and making this session happen. And for the benefit of all the panelists, I can read out some of the comments. They are really applauding the kind of arguments and the case study which has been done. So thank you, sir, and thank you, Dhruv, for that. It wouldn't have happened without you. And last but not least, thank you all the participants, the attendees who've made this webinar so successful. And we hope you can join us in our future webinars. With this, we would like to close the session. And one more thing, depending on the video quality, we will try and upload the session so that it benefits everyone who's not been able to hear or listen to it entirely. And I think that's all from R&R.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dhruv.
Thank you very much. And if the comments are good, you can forward them to us.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone. Stay safe.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.